zokolo do brina katali de bayananga engebo jekele de brina katolo do bobo legebo zokolo do brina katolo do bongre na masokolo do brina kataya na haha engebo jeke ya namaha. Father, we praise and bless the name of Jesus, the name that is above every name. And we rejoice that tonight we are called in that name. Thank you for all that your death, burial, and resurrection has made available to us. And tonight, on the basis of all that you have done for us, we stand boldly and we take possession of all our realities by the word. I pray for everybody connected to this service that the eyes of their understanding flooded with light tonight. Veils full of clarity comes. Your people built up, equipped, edified. We cast down imaginations by the power of your word. We bring down every thought under subjection to the obedience of Christ. And we declare that the word of God rules and reigns. We announce the dominion of God's word over the hearts and minds of men and women all over the world. And we declare that the yoke of bondage is totally terminated. And we give you praise that nobody leaves this service today the same way they came. We give you praise and glory for answered prayer. In Jesus' precious name, and every believer says a powerful amen. Lift your right hands to heaven. Let's release our faith together as we say these words. I am born of God. I am born of the word. The word of God is my nature. I do not struggle to do the word. I do the word naturally. Therefore, today, I will understand the word of his grace. I will be built up. By the end of this service, I will never be the same. Never, ever be the same again. In Jesus' name. And every believer says that amen like thunder. Glory to God. We want to welcome everybody to the service tonight by way of Kingdom Life Network, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, and all of the Akwa Ibom State people that are connected to the service by way of Comfort FM and XL FM. It's a joy to have all of you connected to the service tonight. Do us a favor, invite some people, get some people, call some people on phone to tune to this radio station. The word is going to come with clarity and with power tonight. And those of you on the social media community, do me a favor, please do me a favor tonight. Tag somebody, share with somebody, get some people on, take them the messages, put them on people's pages tonight. Let's just flood the entire Blue Marble planet with the fragrance of God's grace. All our house centers and campuses, is a joy to have all of you connected to the service. Grab your notebook, your pen, and your Bible, and you can be seated with your sweet smart self as we get into the word of his grace again tonight. Is still 30 days of glory, season 7. Glory to God. Now 30 days turn 60 days of glory. All right, so we're still looking at the legal and the vital walk of salvation. The legal and the vital walk of salvation. Hebrews chapter 2, verse number 1. Hebrews chapter 2, verse number 1. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? God also bearing them witness, but with signs and wonders, and with divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. You know, when you hear a subject like this, salvation, you know, subject like salvation, it's easy to have it, you know, by hand. And then you hear some people who will just simply say, are you still learning salvation? Are you still learning salvation? Maybe you are a baby Christian. And then you hear them say, we have moved on. So you ask them, moved on to what? They say, business. We have moved on. Moved on to what? We have moved on to business. Or we have moved on to motivational speaking. All right, now, every transgression, talking about the law of Moses, all right, as basic as this is where most believers err the most. Salvation, as basic, as fundamental as this is where many believers err the most. You know, A few years ago, there's a city in Nigeria called Aba. Aba, A-B-A, is a city in a state called Abia State in the east of Nigeria. It's about an hour drive when, if you know, under all conditions being equal, from my city to that city. And there's this story building that was built with a lot of money on the highway. This building, you know, high rise. It goes right onto a number of floors, about the highest building in that city. And now when you're driving out of that city towards my city, you will see the building by your right, all right? And that building got to the peak up there. They had put everything, windows, glasses, doors, very magnificent, sweet building. Yet nobody was living in it. And then one of the days we were driving by, and I decided to stop and inquire. So I stopped and I asked a few people, what's wrong with the building? Why is nobody there? They said, well, that building has a foundational problem. And when they discovered it had a foundational problem, they had already gotten to the end of the building. That's when they discovered it. So there's no, you know, the government banned anybody from living there because it's risky for human lives. So only madmen, you know, madmen and people, street people who don't have where to stay, sometimes they just go into that building and stay there. That's what it is good for. It is good for nothing other than a building where, you know, mad people and people who are on the street can go and stay. Now, that shows you that as beautiful as that building, just because it has a foundational problem, it is useless. So when somebody says, you know, so you guys are still learning salvation, you mean you're still there? We have moved on. You need to check that person because he doesn't even know what he's talking about. If the foundation has a problem, everything will have a problem. Most of the problems in Christianity today, they are fundamental. A lot of people don't understand the basic foundation of Christianity, which begins with salvation. Brother Paul says to Timothy, from a child you have known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Basic foundation. Now, at what exactly is salvation? Because if you get it right, a lot of things will come to your understanding. We are not just looking at the experience of salvation. We are going beyond the experience. We are looking at the doctrine or the teaching of salvation. Oftentimes, these basic things are the things that make people err the most. When they lack the basic understanding of something this fundamental. Something this fundamental. In fact, when Peter was going to talk about Brother Paul and the revelation of Brother Paul, listen to the way Brother Peter, who was a foremost apostle, spoke about Brother Paul in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 15. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 15. An account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation. Even as our beloved brother Paul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. So the insight, Brother Peter was saying, that the insight that Paul had that differed him from all the apostles, not necessarily in the subject matter, but in the depth of the subject matter, was the fact that Paul was very deep in the subject of salvation. Look at the way Brother Peter will put it in verse 16. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 16. As also in all epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures unto their own destruction. So if a man is wrestling with the revelation of salvation, he can't get anything else. Once a man cannot understand and get the details and the facts of salvation, his Christianity will be hazy, unstable, and his Christianity will be full of darkness, because that is where the matter begins, in the subject of salvation. Now, please pay attention. So the wisdom Brother Paul had that he is going to talk about here is concerning salvation. What was that set him apart from many others? Was the teaching of salvation. So Paul's explanation of the salvation plan of God, The salvation plan of God is what seemingly set him apart from virtually all the other apostles. So the understanding of salvation is very basic. Very basic. Interestingly, the basics are where many people err. The basics. That understanding of Paul, he says, it's concerning salvation. He says, which some who are unlearned and unstable rest. So we can see clearly that what Paul brought forth in his own insight. And you know, you can order our series of teaching that will help you in the defense of the message of Paul. The defense of the Pauline theology. I have a teaching on the defense of the Pauline theology. It is called Understanding the Book of Galatians. Because the book of Galatians, Brother Paul wrote that book in defense of his theology on the New Testament and the grace of God. That's why he will say to the church at Galatia, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another. That was the defense. The entire book of Galatians is the defense of the Pauline theology. And I'll recommend that for you. Understanding the book of Galatians, it will help you a great deal. Now, Brother Paul took time to intelligently, you know, take care of mixture in the book of Galatians. He took care of mixture. In chapter 3, he told the church at Galatia, oh foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Having begun in the spirit, are you now perfected in the flesh? All right, so he took time to systematically deal with the issue of the defense of his theology. That is where he puts down the evidence of his teaching and why he taught the things he taught and the way he taught them. You see, if you can just say, well, God told me, I heard this from heaven, or I feel, or I sense, and you know, all of those things that a lot of people within my camp, the Pentecostals, are always using to cover doctrinal matters. When we start talking doctrine, they start saying, well, you know, the Spirit told me, I feel, I don't feel. You know, and when people talk like that, they have zero respect and reverence for the Word of God. Because otherwise, the scriptures were written by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will not say one thing in the Bible and tell you another thing there. He cannot. He is God. He is consistent. The same yesterday, today, and forever. So, therefore, whatever the Spirit is telling you now that contradicts the text of the scriptures has to be examined. Because the Spirit of God does not speak from the two sides of his mouth. The Spirit of God has consistency in what he says, because he is the truth. And the character of truth is consistency. When it is truth, you don't have to think about it. You just say it because that's the way it is. Anytime you are called upon, you just say the same thing. Because truth does not vary. Truth does not change. Truth is consistent. Now, the problem will be a part of the move of God like I have been in. Sometimes it's the fact that people do not follow through. They do not follow through the teachings of the word. It's like some people who think they've been ministers of the gospel for a long time, or some people think they have been born again for many years, or some people think they have been Christians for many years. They have read the Bible over and over. So when they hear us teach, there's an air that they have. There's a way they look at what we're teaching as if, you know, these little boys, let's hear what they are trying to say. But when they speak, you know that they have not even read the Bible properly. They are reading the Bible out of context. And that is why it is of the essence to follow through the teachings of God's word. Not just snippets. Not just out of a series of 30 hours, you listen to 2 hours and you conclude. No, you're not being intelligent that way. You've got to listen to everything properly to be able to arrive at the gist of the message. Can you imagine? Jesus looked at 39 books of the Old Testament. 39 books written over so many years. By so many people, doctors, lawyers, farmers, traders, all of them were involved in writing the entire book. Prophets prophesied, the law of Moses, different prophets, and after all have been put together, Jesus shows up and said, search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. He said, all of them put together testify of me. Can you imagine that? The Jews couldn't take that. The Jews couldn't understand that because that didn't make sense to them. But actually, That is why they couldn't understand anything about Jesus. That's why he came to his own, but they couldn't receive him. They couldn't. Why? Because they thought they knew too much, but they knew nothing. I mean, imagine a young man, like the rich young ruler. Rich young ruler. This guy is rich, he's got money. He's young, he's got energy for the money, because there's an age where you don't need money. And a real old man doesn't need money. It will be useless to him. It's young guys that need money, who have the energy to spend it. So this guy was rich. He was young. Not just the two. He was a ruler. So power, money, influence, and youth on his side. But the Bible says he saw Jesus and he came to Jesus and he said, "Good master, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus looked at him and said, "You know the Ten Commandments. You know the Ten Commandments. Keep them and everything will be all right." He looked at Jesus and said to Jesus, "Don't insult me. I am a Pharisee. I know the Torah by heart. Whatever you're talking about, the Ten Commandments, if I haven't kept them, I wouldn't be, a Pharisee. I've kept them from my youth. All of them put together, I am a moralist. Where morality is concerned, I am blameless. I am a Pharisee among my people." And the Bible says Jesus loving him, which means the guy didn't lie. Jesus looked at him and loving him, said to him, "I know you have kept all the rules of morality." That's why there's no salvation in morality. "I know you have kept the rules of morality, but one thing thou lackest. One thing thou lackest." After all your morality, one thing that thou lackest. That's why there's no salvation in conduct. One thing thou lackest. Then Jesus went into his greed. "Go and sell all that you have. Give to the poor. Take your cross. Come and follow me." And the man was very sad. He was very sad and he went away. What Jesus was saying is, all put together minus me is a waste of time. But if you have me and you don't have morality, me in you will produce morality, which is the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness. The life of God is not an upgrade of the former life. No. The life of God is a brand new life. A believer does not have a change of behavior. A believer does not have a change of attitude. No. Christianity is not change your behavior. Christianity is not change your attitude. Christianity is not the things I used to do, I do them before, no more. Any moral instructor can help you to improve on your conduct. That's not Christianity. Christianity is a brand new life. A brand new life. When you receive Christ, Christ coming in to your heart is Christianity. Christ coming in. It's the entirety of God's kingdom coming into a man and taking up residence in that man. That arrival of Christ into a man is what we call salvation. That's what we call born again. That's what we call Christianity. Christ coming in as your life. Look at Colossians chapter 3, verse number 4. Colossians chapter 3, verse number 4. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear. When Christ, who is our life. Christ is our life. Born again is receiving Christ. Brother John calls it eternal life. Brother Paul calls it in Christ. If any man in Christ is eternal life. Eternal life is in Christ. Look at John chapter 10 verse 10. John chapter 10 verse 10. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life. So until Christ comes, there is no life. The coming of Christ into a man is the arrival of life. No Jesus, no life. No Jesus, no life. So when Christ enters, new life enters. not an upgrade, not an improvement of the old life, not a refurbishment of the old life, not an adjustment of the old life. Mm-mm. It's not character modification. Mm-mm. It's not an improvement on your attitude and behavior. No. That's not Christianity at all. Christianity is new life taking up residence in a man, a brand new life. We are his workmanship, created, not recreated, created, fresh creation. Ephesians 2:10. We are his workmanship, created, fresh creation in Christ Jesus unto good works. But first of all, it is the creation before the good works. Many of you, your problem is you want the good works to validate the Christianity. It is the Christianity that validates the good works. Don't put the cart before the horse. You have to have the new life first. And let me tell you this. The life of God comes with the character of God. The life of God, you don't add anything to this life. This life is self-contained. This life has everything it needs within it. Look at it. I am come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Why does Jesus have to come in for you to have life? Because Ephesians chapter 2 verse 1, a man without Christ, you who were dead in trespasses and sins. Look up. You who were dead. A man without Christ is dead. And somebody said, but I am still moving around. No, you are dead. Look at the next verse. You are dead. Wherein in time past you walked. So you were dead, but you were walking. According to the course of this world. According to the prince of the power of the air. The spirit that now walketh in the children of disobedience. Among whom also we all had our lifestyle in time past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature, the children of wrath, even as others. Look at me for a minute. So, without Christ, you are dead. Christianity is not an improvement on the dead. It's not a renovation of the dead. It's not a practice of character modification on the dead. No. It's brand new life. I am come that you may have life. Christianity is to be born of the spirit. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Christianity is to be born of God. Whatsoever is born, the believer doesn't have a past. He has a fresh start in God. He has a fresh start in God. Now watch. Because he is born of the Spirit, many people, their problem is, what about Christ? Are you saying that a Christian can just be sinning anyhow? No. That's not what we are talking. And if you're still thinking like that, you're either mischievous or you are far from the truth of God's kingdom. You are either mischievous or you are far from the truth of God's kingdom. Look at Galatians chapter 5 verse number 16. Galatians chapter 5 verse number 16. This I say then, walk in the spirit. Why should you walk in the spirit? Because you are born of the spirit. You are born of the spirit. So your walk is in. You live in. You are born in the spirit. So you walk in the spirit. Walk in the spirit. Now come down and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So a man in the spirit does not fulfill the lust of the flesh. How do I know that? The book of Romans chapter 8 verse number 8. Romans chapter 8 verse 8. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. Next verse. But you are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. How? If so be that the spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the spirit of Christ, he is none of his. If you don't have the spirit of Christ, you are none of his. Now come back to Galatians. Let's see the character that the life of God produces, what we call our conduct as believers, what we call our morality as believers, what we call as our lifestyle as believers. Galatians chapter 5 verse number 22. Galatians 5:22. But the fruit of the spirit is love. That's our character. The fruit of the spirit is the character and the morality of the believer. And this fruit is inside the spirit that the believer is born of. It's not character modification. It's not a set of rules and regulations. It is in his nature. This fruit is part of his DNA. The fruit of the spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such, there is no law. So the question is, so if a believer is not experiencing these fruits, what is the problem? Two things. He's either a fake brother or a fake sister, or he is born of God but has not grown spiritually. He is born of God but has not experienced spiritual growth because he has not submitted himself to the teaching of God's word. How do I know that? 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse number 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 17. Now, the Lord is that spirit. And where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Glory to God. Next verse. Woo. But we all that are born of the spirit, with open face, no more veil, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed. We are changed as we behold into that same image from glory to glory, even as by the spirit of the Lord. So the believer that is born of the spirit begins to behold. He sits down under the teaching of the word of God. And as he begins to behold Jesus, in Jesus, he sees his true identity. As long as he's looking at Jesus, the change is by the spirit of the Lord. It is not a set of rules and regulations. There is a working of the spirit going on his inside as long as he is beholding the mirror. He is changed into that same image from glory to glory, even as by the working of the spirit. Why? For it is God that worketh in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. As long as you keep looking at the mirror. The illustration that makes this easy is Jesus walking on the water. Peter saw Jesus walking on the water. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, if you're the one, bid me to come to you on the water. And Jesus said to Peter, come. Peter got up. As long as his eyes were on Jesus, he walked on the water. As long as his eyes were on Jesus, he walked on the water. The moment Peter took his eyes away from Jesus and began to look at the winds and the waves, he began to sink. Why? Because it is only as long as you're looking at the mirror that you are changed into that same image from glory to glory. So we see Jesus. We do not look at our weakness. The devil wants you, listen carefully, the devil wants you to look at yourself. The devil wants you to focus on yourself, because when you look at yourself, you see weakness. You see inabilities. When you look at yourself, you see struggles. When you look at yourself, you see defeat. When you look at yourself, you see shame and embarrassment. And the devil wants you to focus on yourself. Religion wants you to focus on yourself. Legalism wants you to look at yourself so you see how wretched you are. But ladies and gentlemen, looking unto Jesus, when you begin to look at Jesus, in Jesus you see strength. In Jesus you see your true identity. In Jesus you see your true value and worth. In Jesus you see your true authority. In Jesus you see your victory over the devil and his cohorts. In Jesus you see your resources, your capacity and your ability. And when you behold him, Matonakata, when you behold him and you see him, in him you see who you are. And then you begin, those fruits in you begin to find expression. It's not character modification. That's not Christianity. It is beholding Christ. And as you behold Christ, the life of Christ in you begins to find expression. As you are beholding, that's why the teaching of God's word is the cure for everything in the kingdom. Once you are born again, the next thing is teaching. That's why God gave us teachers. That's why God gave us Jesus. The moment Jesus rose from the dead, the first thing we did was to give us teachers. Even if you're struggling with addiction, look at Jesus. Those of you that have been asking questions on homosexuals, lesbians, and gay, look, Jesus loves them like he loves you. There's no difference. There's no difference in the sight of God. If you're homosexual or you're struggling with your feelings, you know, for the opposite sex, just behold Jesus. As you begin to behold Jesus and you focus on Jesus, you begin to change into that same image. When that change begins to take place, when that change begins to take place, your feelings begin to change also. Your feelings begin to change. You know the prodigal son? The prodigal son just stood up one day and said, what am I doing here? Nobody preached. He just reasoned right. What am I doing here? How many hired servants does my father have? Enough to eat and to spare. I will arise. I'll go back to my father. And I will say, I'm no more worthy to be called your son. Make me a servant. The father waited for the boy. As he saw the boy, he ran, grabbed the boy and said, my son. The father called him my son. The father never called him prodigal. Once a son, always a son. The father said, my son. And the father changed his clothing and everything and threw a party for the boy. Listen carefully. It is right thinking that produces right living. It is not right living for right thinking. You are changing, twisting things. It won't work. It is right thinking. And right thinking is a product of right hearing. What are you hearing? Take heed what you hear. When you start hearing right, you start thinking right. When you start thinking right, you start living right. As a man thinketh, so is he. When we behold the glory as in a mirror, we are changed into that same image. But it begins with beholding the glory of God as in a mirror. Because Jesus is the author and the perfecter of our faith. Oh, brother Paul will say, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun this work of salvation in you, we will be faithful to finish it. He is the founder of salvation, and he is the finisher of salvation. Your part is just to enjoy what he does by the work of the Holy Spirit in your heart. We all, with open faces, beholding the glory of the Lord. So that life of the believer, that life, Christ our life, when he enters you, along with his coming is the fruit of the Spirit in him. That's his character. And then there are gifts of the Spirit. That is his charisma. So we don't borrow charisma from motivational speakers. And we don't borrow character. The character and the charisma is inherent in that life. However, they find expression as we behold the glory. They find expression as we look into the perfect law of liberty. Glory to God. As we keep looking, the word keeps coming. As we keep looking, the word keeps coming. And as the word is coming, revelation is growing. As revelation is growing, your identity is becoming reinforced. Suddenly, the change that cannot be explained begins to break forth. Suddenly, your appetite changes. Suddenly, your desires change. Suddenly, your mind changes. Suddenly, a brand new man from inside is manifested out. We are inside out, not outside in. We are inside out, not outside in. We are inside out people. Am I communicating at all? We are inside out people. These are fundamentals. If you don't know them, you will keep arguing blindly. These are fundamentals. So the born again man is not an improvement on Adam. The born again man is not an updated version of Adam. The born again man is not a renovated person. The born again man is a brand new life that comes with his character and with his charisma. The charisma, the charis, the gifts, the manifestations of God's grace through the man is what we call our own ephesi. The believer has ephesi, gifts of the spirit. Where you walk into a place and by discernment you can tell. Where you walk into a place and by revelation you can tell. Nothing takes you by surprise. Yeah. Those that are matured or full of age, they have their senses exercised. They can discern between good and evil. It takes growth and maturity to come there. And this growth and maturity comes by the word. As newborn babes desire the sincere milk. So if there is sincere milk, it means that there is insincere milk. It didn't say desire milk. Milk is not milk. He said desire the sincere milk. For there to be a qualifier means not every milk is good for the believer. Desire the sincere milk of the word. Why? That you may grow thereby. And brother Peter says grow in grace and grow in the knowledge. So growing in knowledge is growing in grace. And when you grow in grace, you abound unto every good work. Can somebody shout a powerful amen? Now, so many believers don't understand these fundamentals. They just assume a lot of things and end up being an opposition to the message. They assume a lot of things and end up being an opposition to the message. And this is not the first time this happens. They just assume, you know, they just assume because they are not following through. And when a man doesn't follow through, he will assume, of course. He will think he knows, but he that knows not and knoweth not that he knows not is a fool. Shut him down. You didn't hear that. He that knows not and knoweth not that he knows not is a fool. Shut him down. Bible tells us that there are people that are unlearned and they have foolish questions. Unlearned, and their questions are a reflection of the quality of what they know. And say, so if they are unlearned and they are producing foolish questions, he said, avoid them. So there are some people you avoid because they refuse to humble themselves to be taught so that they can speak out of the depth of the wisdom that comes by the teaching of God's word. So that is why some people are full of assumptions. Full of assumptions. They know nothing and they know not that they know nothing. So such people, you don't waste your energy on them. Now, we do not take a stand in the world. Somebody say, my stand is this. No, this is the way I see it. No, nobody has the way we see it. We have to see it the way it is supposed to be seen. Peter did not say Paul has a stand. Peter simply said, Paul is deeper than I am. We know our brother Paul, that Paul is deeper than I am. So instead of taking a stand, it's better to say that insight this guy has is more than my own. And once you acknowledge that, you are on your pathway to teaching. You are on your pathway to learning. No, you know, we are not in a competition. We are in this thing to help each other. We are in these things to make one another see what we see so we can all get better in the kingdom. The Bible says, no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation, meaning is of any private origin. Jesus said, search the scriptures. In them you think you have eternal life, but the scriptures don't give eternal life. Rather, they are they which testify of me. They testify
of me. So there is a body of insight. Everything speaks about a person. The scriptures testify of me, meaning there is a body of insight. The scriptures speaks about a person. The scriptures testify of a person, not an object, not a system of beliefs. The scriptures testify of a person. The scriptures do not testify of an object, neither a system of beliefs. No, it is from that person that the scriptures testify of that we derive a system of beliefs. It is from that person that the scriptures testify of that we derive our system of beliefs. So it is not the system of beliefs first, it is the person. When we see the logos of God, the logic, God's intent. When we see into God's intent and plan, out of that intent and plan, we derive a system of belief. Please stay with me. We derive a system of belief. So, the will of God, therefore, is salvation. The will of God, therefore, is salvation. When Jesus said, "Your will be done. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." People think what he is saying is that your will is in heaven. Bring it to earth. No, that's not what he's saying. What he is saying is the will of God is salvation. Let me establish it further. 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 3. 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 3. "For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior." Next verse. Who will? That's the will of God. "Who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth." And to come unto the knowledge of the truth. So, the will of God, we see what Peter says in salvation. It is not the will of God that any soul should perish. So, what is the will of God? Salvation. It is not the will of God, Peter speaking. He said the Lord is not slack concerning his promise. Alright, then he says it's not the will of God that any soul should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That is the will of God. So in Matthew chapter 7, when Jesus says, "He that doeth the will of my Father, he that doeth," let me read it. Matthew 7, 24 to 27. Matthew chapter 7, 24 to 27. "Therefore, whosoever heareth the sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not. It fell not, for it was founded upon a rock." Next verse. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it. The other house, where the man heareth not the sayings, the house fell, and great was the fall of it. So the will of God there, "He that doeth the will of my Father, is he that heareth these words and doeth them." Doing them means he believes. You heard the message, you believe the message. Faith in Christ is the doing that is required of a believer. Faith in Christ. So, doeth the will of my Father is to accept the offer of God's saving grace. That is the will of God. Look at John chapter 3 verse 5. See the way Jesus spoke to Nick at night. John 3, 5. Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water, that is of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." Water, that is the Spirit. There are no two elements to salvation. The next thing he talks about is being born of the Spirit. Because there's only one way a man enters the kingdom. You enter the kingdom of God by being born of the Spirit, not by works, by being born of the Spirit. It's a birth. It's not effort. It's not a set of do's and don'ts. It's not a set of rules and regulations. It is a birth. You don't join the kingdom. Mm-mm. You don't join the kingdom of God. You don't join it. You don't enter the kingdom of God. You don't enter. You are born into the kingdom. You have to be born. It's not like church membership. You have to be born by Jesus. You have to be birthed into the kingdom. A man must be born to be a part of the kingdom. Look at Colossians chapter 1 verse 12. Colossians chapter 1 verse 12. Giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. The word meet there is he qualified you. So you don't qualify for the kingdom. Christ qualifies you. You don't qualify. That's why I say giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us. The word meat is the old English word. It's not cow or goat. Meat there is old English for qualified or fit. Who has made us meat? Who qualified us? God. Then chapter 1 verse 13 now says, who hath he qualified us? Then he delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear son. Into the kingdom of his dear son. Next verse. In whom we have. So he qualified us. He delivered us into the kingdom of his son. Now because of what he did, we have redemption. We have redemption. Through his sacrificial work. Even the forgiveness of sin. The word blood there means his sacrificial work. His sacrificial work. Alright, his sacrificial work means the forgiveness of sin. So, he is not asking you to be doing the will of God. Mm-mm. He that doeth, not he that is doing. It has a closure. He that doeth the will of my Father. Doeth, meaning that doeth is once. You accept Christ once. Once he entered you, you have done the will of the Father. Once you receive Christ and he enters you, you have done the will of the Father. So the will of God is one thing. It's not asking you to be doing the will of God. The will of God is one thing, salvation. So the will of God is a fact. The will of God is a fact. And that fact is salvation. That fact is soteria. The will of God is a fact. That fact is soteria. Now, please pay attention. That fact is soteria. Matola dabaha. Now, don't be saying, what is the will of God? Maybe the will of God is holiness. Or maybe the will of God is righteousness. All those things, righteousness, holiness, sanctification, all of them come by virtue of salvation. All of them, holiness, sanctification, all of them will only come after a man is saved. You can't be holy without salvation. You can't be sanctified without salvation. You can't be righteous without salvation. It is salvation that makes you righteous. It is the salvation that Jesus has provided in his death, burial, and resurrection that makes you righteous, holy, accepted, justified, you know, and all the adjectives that defines your reality in Christ Jesus. Please stay with me. Stay with me. I'm enjoying this. Now, so please pay attention. The understanding, therefore, that we have in the scriptures is the understanding that comes from the person of Jesus. The understanding, therefore, that we have in the scriptures is the understanding that comes from the person of Jesus. Also, we have said this earlier, that salvation is of the earth. Salvation is of the earth. Salvation is not something that happens in heaven. Salvation is of the earth. All right? and in understanding the basic concept of salvation. Jesus is our explanation. In understanding the basic concept of salvation, Christ is our explanation. People talk about God's sovereignty, the sovereignty of God. Somebody got so angry with me. Dr. Damina is preaching against the sovereignty of God. The only people that will listen to him are people who don't know me. Because people who know me and have followed, knowing me now, I don't mean you know me from my village. When I say you know me, what I mean is you know what I preach and I stand for. You followed my teaching. That's what I mean by know me. Please, let's get it straight now. So when you hear me say, somebody knows me, what I'm saying is, he has understood what I teach. Very, very important. Leave that in. Very important. Now, somebody who knows me cannot say, I do not preach the sovereignty of God. How can I? Am I mad? I'm not mad. How can I know? How can God not be sovereign? However, the sovereignty of God must be explained. Otherwise, if you preach the sovereignty of God out of explanation, you will arrive at concluding that it was God that made Adam to sin. And which is not true, because that's not the scriptures. So that's why the sovereignty of God must be explained. Because if it's not explained, you will conclude that God is behind sin, God is behind sickness, God is behind disease, God is behind everything. In fact, you will conclude that when you wake up in the morning and hit your left leg on your bed, it was God that hit the leg for you. You will conclude that when you ate a particular food and your stomach started running, that is God that wanted your stomach to run. You will soon conclude that when you have a fever, it is God trying to teach you a lesson through a fever. So at the end of the day, both good and bad and evil will be God, because you are teaching a heresy that is not scriptural. So the sovereignty of God, therefore, must be well explained. You cannot teach the sovereignty of God to be all inclusive of man's choices. You cannot teach the sovereignty of God to be all inclusive of a man's decisions and choices independent of God. You see that? God told Adam and Eve, that tree, don't eat of it. The day you eat of it, the day you eat of it, you will surely die. A loving father warning his children of the consequence of an action. And God left. Adam rejected the advice of a loving father and made the choice to eat of it. That is Adam's choice, independent of God. You can't call that the sovereignty of God. Anybody teaching that is an atheist. He doesn't know God. I don't care how long he's been in. I don't even care how many titles are on his name. Anybody teaching that doesn't know God. Because you cannot know God outside Christ. If you don't know Christ, you don't know God. Christ is the definition of God. Christ is the explanation of God. You can never know God if you don't know Christ. Christ brought God to us. He is the image of the invisible God. You cannot see God. You only see God in Christ. Christ said, he that has seen me has seen the Father. So if you don't know Christ, you don't know the Father. No one can come to the Father except by me. That's what Jesus said. Why? I am the truth. So if there is any truth to be known about God, it has to be Christ. Christ is the person of the truth. He is the person of the way. He is the person of life. He comes in, life comes in. He that has the Son has life. So since Jesus is the embodiment of truth, only what Christ says about God is the truth. Anything else anybody is saying is not the truth if it contradicts what the truth himself reveals about the Father. Christ is the embodiment of the truth concerning God. You cannot know God outside the person of Christ. So now, the sovereignty of God is not one act out of God's choice that God just chooses to do anything he feels like doing. No. Jesus is the Word. Jesus is the logos, the logic. That's why he is the thought of God. Jesus is the mind of God. So both the thought and the mind of God is revealed only in one person. Both the thought and the mind of God is revealed only in one person. The thought And the mind of God is revealed only in one person. It is not revealed in God's actions. It is revealed in the person of Jesus. Now that's big, and I want to repeat that. That is, the sovereignty of God is not revealed in God's actions. It is only revealed in the person of Jesus, who summarizes all of God's actions. Jesus summarizes all of God's actions. So the sovereignty of God is not revealed in God's actions independent of Jesus. You didn't hear that. The sovereignty of God is not revealed in God's actions independent of Jesus. No. The sovereignty of God is revealed in the person of Jesus, who summarizes all of God's actions. Jesus is the summary, the definition, the borderline, and the yardstick for God's actions. Jesus is the summary. He is the yardstick. He is the boundary. He is the revelation. Nekato magada. He is the precision, the exactness. He is the accuracy of the definition of God's character. So if you miss Jesus, you miss God. If you miss Jesus, you miss God. If you miss Jesus, you miss God. Because the thought of God and the mind of God is revealed only in the person of Jesus. Stay with me. So pay attention now. Pay attention. In 1 Corinthians 2:16, as a roundup. Kabayada. Tomorrow is Sunday. Double barrel, first and second service, God punished the devil. Nekatobada. For who had known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? Kabayada. But we have. We have the mind of Christ. When I was in school, they used to teach us that the mind of Christ there means mentality. That is, it means your mind. You know, that mind where you use for study. When he said we have the mind of Christ, is a clear explanation that you can find in the scriptures. He had previously said, before he arrived at this conclusion, let's read the pretext, verse 8. Let's start from verse 8 of 1 Corinthians 2. We'll read down to verse 16. Pay attention, please, as a roundup. 1 Corinthians, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Next verse. But as it is written, I had not seen, nor ear heard, neither have they entered into the heart of men the things which God had prepared for them that love him. Next verse. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. Glory to God. Now, we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know, ginosko, the things that are freely given to us of God. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth. Economics, soap making, motivational speaking, skill acquisition. Which man's wisdom teacheth? That is not our syllabus for ministry. Which man's wisdom teacheth? But which the Holy Ghost, holy men speak as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Which the Holy Ghost is not a new teaching. That is the scriptures, the breath, the scriptures that were breathed by God, which the Holy Ghost teacheth. So, what do we do in ministry? Comparing spiritual things with spiritual. Next verse. But the natural man who is waiting for soap making, The natural man who is looking for skill acquisition, how to survive the after effects of COVID-19 as the curriculum of the church, who is looking for how I can put food on my table, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness. They are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritual judgeth all things. Yet he himself is judged of no man. Ooh. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. We have the mind of Christ. We have God's thinking pattern. We have God's mindset. We have God's thinking pattern. That is, we have access into God's pattern of thinking. We have it in the person of Jesus Christ. Stand on your feet. That's all I've got for you tonight. Glory to God. Father, I pray for everybody under the sound of my voice. Men and women, boys and girls, ministers of the gospel, people around the world that are hooked up to these services. Lord, I pray tonight that this revelation grows big in the hearts of your people until nothing else matters. Veils fall off, barriers terminated, shattered, mindsets totally broken, and ideas subdued. That the revelation of Jesus, words which the Holy Ghost teacheth, kabarananga, words which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spirituals with spirituals, that these words which the natural man lacks the capacity and ability to receive, that men connected to this service receive the ability by the power of the Holy Ghost to receive these words. Jesus said the world cannot receive them, but you receive them because you know me. Father, thank you for your word, that your word grows and prevails in our hearts, in our communities. The word of the Lord grows and prevails in a quibum state, religion, darkness collapsing like a pack of cards. The word of God grows and prevails against falsehood, and it prevails against deception. That the word of God grows and subdues and shines in the midst of darkness. And I pray for everybody connected to the service tonight, barriers totally terminated. Those in need of a miracle, receive a miracle tonight. Sick bodies healed by the power of God's word. For no word of God shall be void of power. Father, we give you praise in Jesus' precious name. And every believer says that amen on a note of finality. Glory to God. Listen to me. I'll be joining Mr. Michael Bush in another 2 minutes. He's already in the building, man. Good to see you tonight. Listen carefully. Just before we go to the next segment in the other studio, where we shall be interacting with you tonight, answering questions and bringing clarity to things that you are yet to be clear about in the word of God, and fellowshipping together with all of you, opening phone lines and receiving phone calls so we interact. I'm so excited to announce that 60 days of glory is what we're heading to. Tomorrow will be the last day of 30 days of glory, and Monday, the 3rd of August, will be the first day of the part 2 of the 60 days of glory, which begins on Monday. And we're going to run until the 6th of September, God punished the devil. That's what we know for now. The rest we will discover. We shall know better by and by. Glory to God. I'm excited, I tell you. I'm excited because I have many things I want to teach that these 30 days could not accommodate. But I'm glad now I have more space to pour the rest. Okabada, God punish the devil. There's no need to keep it for next year. Next year has its own portion aside from this year's. So let's exhaust this year. Now, call a friend or family. Call somebody, share the videos. We're going to have a powerful time of interacting. Get a good offering. Let's give tonight. And remember, tomorrow is partnership. Tomorrow we're raising the money for the next 30 days. We're asking everybody to give sacrificially and prayerfully and intentionally to help us pay the bills for the next 30 days of glory. But hey guys, we appreciate you, partners and friends of this ministry, who have sacrificially given to support this vision. you know, my God supplies all your needs. And thank you for giving. Grab an offering, everybody, online. The radio audience, in a few minutes, Mr. Michael Bush will give you the banking details. But those of you online and on TV, the screen, you know, on the screen, banking details are scrolling. And if you're in an area where the account does not affect you, you want an account, if you email drabeldamina@yahoo.com, you will get from us the details of the account that is peculiar to your location. Thank you again for giving. Lift your offerings up, Father. We give in faith. We give with joy. And we thank you for the privilege of honoring the word, honoring Christ, and honoring our collective assignment to flood the blue marble planet with the gospel of Christ. Oh, Father, it's an honor and a privilege. Thank you that through our money, we can get the good news of Christ into the homes and lives of humanity. And we pray that tonight, everybody giving, your needs are met supernaturally in the name of Jesus. Thank you for the blessing upon this meeting tonight and upon your people tonight. In Jesus' precious name. And every believer says that amen on a note of finality. Glory! Listen, I'll be connecting with you in another 1 minute as we switch over to Mr. Michael Bush. And until then, enjoy the grace of Christ. Let's celebrate viewers around the world. Glory! Glory!
By this message, for these all the messages and books by Dr. Abel Damina, please call +234